morning.
Good morning.
Happy Palm Sunday to you all. And today we'll be encouraged to live your faith and show Christ. And with that, we'll begin with the first hymn.
No tramp of soldiers marching.
We failed to live by God's standards. Let us confess our sins to God our Father, asking Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins. And trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given His only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by His authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
With that, children, you can come forward. So, kids, this is the beginning of Holy Week. This is known as Palm Sunday. You probably got that general impression, didn't you? So, yeah. On Palm Sunday, Jesus went riding into Jerusalem And everybody was praising him, shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, save now." And probably many of the people were thinking he was going to come to rescue them away from Roman rule and be the new king. Well, he did come as a king, but he came in a very strange way, didn't he? He came riding on a colt, the foal of a donkey, a burro. So he was on that donkey was probably only, his back was only about right here. It's that tall, just a little thing. It must have looked strange to see Jesus riding on such a little animal. In fact, Matthew's gospel that we're going to hear in a little while tells us that he was actually riding on the colt or foal and his mother. I'm not exactly sure how he rode on two at once, but somehow that's what the Bible tells us. So we'll believe him. Anyway, why would he come on something that looked so lowly? Because he wants us to have the same lowly attitude, not expecting, "I'm going to do whatever I want for myself, and you better give me whatever I want." No, it's the other way around. It's, he came not to be served, but to serve. In fact, to give his life as a ransom for many. He not only served us by coming as that lowly king, he came not only washing his disciples' feet, which he also did, as a way to show, to serve, but he also served us by carrying your sins and mine and everybody else's to the cross and dying for them all. Wow. Well, you and I can never serve the Lord that well, can we? But he certainly gives us opportunities to serve him by also serving other people. So let's continue to do so, praising the Lord in the process. Yes, sugar time. I tell you to take one along for your little brother, but I don't think so.
Doesn't know how to eat chocolate.
Okay. Oh, he will.
He still
won't learn. Zechariah foretold how Jesus would triumphantly enter Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, announcing his heavenly kingdom that he was about to open to us and to all people through his death and resurrection. Our Old Testament lesson is recorded in Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 and 10. "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth." This is the word of God. As we share in the joy of that first Palm Sunday, may we sing and shout our praise to Jesus. Hosanna, save now. Our gospel lesson is recorded in the Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 21, beginning with the first verse. Please rise for the words and works of the Lord Jesus. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet, "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." This is the gospel of our Lord. We pray. We praise you, O God, for the great acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ. As he was acclaimed by those who scattered their garments and branches of palms in his path, so may we always hail him as our King and follow him with perfect confidence, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated during the next hymn.
Ride on, ride on.
From our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of God that we'll consider as the epistle lesson for this Palm Sunday, recorded in Philippians chapter 2, beginning with the 5th verse. "Indeed, let this attitude be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Though he was by nature God, he did not consider equality with God as a prize to be displayed. But he emptied himself by taking the nature of a servant. When he was born in human likeness and in his appearance was like that of any other man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." This is the word of God. Fellow believers in Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior, King of all, if there's one thing that frustrates me, I'd have to say it's traffic. and I know my wife could attest to it many times over. In fact, it's almost guaranteed that if I get out on the road, I'll either wind up behind some tractor, or I'm going to wind up behind somebody who refuses to even do the speed limit. And no place to pass. And of course, once we get to the highway, to the four lane, well then, when they don't have anybody they can hold up anymore, then they take off and zip past. Pretty soon they're out of sight. So what bothers you? I'm sure there's something that frustrates you. Might be something big, might be something small, but any and all of us get frustrated with something from time to time. So, the biggest issue, though, with my being frustrated, and maybe also with you when you're frustrated, really isn't what causes me to be frustrated, but why? As I consider that, I can only hang my head in shame, because what's really causing me to be frustrated is that somehow or other, I figure I deserve better. That somehow I have the right to things going my way, even if it might mean that it doesn't go the way somebody else would like it. Maybe you sometimes would have that problem too. Our own sinful pride sometimes gets in the way, and we expect a little bit more and think more of ourselves in the process and less of the other person. Well, about that time, it's time to realize that it's not them, but I need an attitude adjustment. Well, just such an attitude adjustment is what Paul addresses today in his letter to the Philippians. He says, in the words prior to our text, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look at not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others." So stop assuming that someone owes you or me something, and consider instead how we can show them love and concern. Instead, lift them up. I know what would stop my frustration. It's really something very simple. I just have to start out a little sooner. If I start out a little bit sooner, then I wouldn't feel rushed, and what's more, I wouldn't have to try to push them down the road. I could just relax and take things easy. I know that's easy to say, but it's another thing to do it. At least I know what I'm supposed to do. But no matter what your frustration is, we all need attitude adjustments from time to time. So Paul tells us your attitude should be like that of Christ Jesus. So, at the beginning of this Holy Week, we turn our attention to the greatest week in all of history, and we urge you, live your faith and show Christ. Let this attitude be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Though he was by nature God, he did not consider equality with God as a prize to be displayed. So what exactly does Paul mean by that? Well, I think there's a good example. In the Roman Empire, if you were the general that conquered some enemy somewhere, and you came back to Rome, well, you would bring back in a parade all the spoils of that battle that you fought. If the people happened to have been peoples that made fine linen, then you'd have people carrying fine linens behind you in the parade. If they happened to be a people that had many jewels and gold and silver, well, then you'd have them carrying those things in the parade behind you, all to show you, show the people of Rome, that you were now raising the standard of life for all of them concerned. Well, that's really what's meant here. Jesus is God. And therefore, he could have come back, as he will at the end of time, in all of his glory and majesty and splendor. But he chose not to. He chose instead to come humbly. He could have shown himself to be the God he is, along with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Show everybody all at once. But he chose not to. He emptied himself by taking the very nature of a servant when he was born in human likeness and his appearance was like that of any other man. In other words, if you had looked at Jesus, you wouldn't have automatically thought, wow, he's God. In fact, as nice as all those pictures are of Jesus that we have so often in our minds, Jesus wasn't even that pretty. That's what the Bible tells us. Isaiah foretold he had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. Now, we do know that from Hebrews 4, there was still one tremendously enormous difference between him and you and me. It says, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses. But we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we are, yet was without sin. Yes, Jesus was a human being just like the rest of us, but there was a huge difference between him and us. We sin daily. He never sinned once. What a huge difference that is. Now let's go back to that attitude adjustment. Since we sin daily, we do need an attitude adjustment. And Paul tells us that just as Jesus humbled himself, he did it for two reasons. He not only did it so that he would live humbly and then die perfectly for your sins and mine and everyone else's. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. But Paul also tells us there's another reason. That just as he came humbly, so our attitude should definitely be one of a humble faith. From when we're little on, don't we cry out, look, Mom, look, Dad, see what I've done? We're trying to draw attention to ourselves somehow or other. We want people to see we're special in some way. Well, our society certainly tells us we are special, right? Our society tries to convince us all the time that we need to gain self-esteem. The more we believe in ourselves, the stronger we'll be, and everything will be wonderful in our life. And yet, somehow, we never quite achieve that, do we? And Mr. Rogers always kept telling us, you're very special just the way you are. Well, the fact is that whether Mr. Rogers said so or not, God doesn't. In and of ourselves, we might as well forget it. Because God doesn't tell us we're special in and of ourselves. He tells us we're worthless. There is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands, no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. So, those words certainly fly in the face of everything we hear from our culture that tries to promote self-esteem. God takes our self-esteem and knocks it right down. Knocks us right down. And says, in and of yourself, you are worthless in my sight. And for those who never turn to the Lord, he's going to wind up telling them that forever too, since we've sinned against him. Worthless. But thank God he doesn't leave it there. He only wants us to turn to him, to be humbled. Not crushed, but humbled. And then God lifts us up from being humbled in spirit. He crushes our self-worth, but then he tells us that through Jesus, we are now not just nice, as far as he's concerned, but perfect. He tells us that through Jesus, we are very special, yes, precious in his sight. God not only holds Jesus as his dear son, he holds you and me as his dear children. You are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. And Peter declares you are a chosen people, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praise of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. So in God's sight, we are special now. Only as we humble ourselves before him, turn away from our own selves, deny ourselves, declare ourselves worthless in and of ourselves, but then turn to him in faith, knowing that our dear Savior Jesus won a special place for us with God. We'll learn to say with the hymnist, nothing in my hands I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. And in that way, we'll imitate Christ by humbling ourselves. But Christ Jesus didn't stop there. Paul directs us to see that he not only spoke humbly, but he lived it as well. So, for us to live it as well. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. He didn't simply humble himself in words or attitude of the mind, but in the attitude of his actions as well. And of course, that's why I mentioned to the children how he washed his disciples' feet, showing his humility. And then he reminds us that he did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Well, you and I might not revel in the idea of washing anybody's feet. God still wants us to imitate Christ. He paid the ransom price for your sins and mine. Not just washing feet, but dying for us. So he wants us to imitate him in serving. We want to have a serving faith. Now, once again, that flies right in the face of our whole culture, doesn't it? In fact, in our own lives too. What? Serve? Me? Serve? Somebody else? I want to be served. Isn't that why we go to restaurants? So we can be served instead of have to do all the work ourselves? That's just one little example. You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave to of all. To imitate Christ Jesus, we'll want to serve one another in love. That means, rather than to draw attention to ourselves, we'll want to lift others up, even above us. To draw attention to Jesus above all. In fact, Jesus himself said, "A city on a hill cannot be hidden, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." Not you, him. Quietly, patiently serve others. And in this way, hopefully, they'll see Jesus through you and me, and they'll learn to praise our Heavenly Father all the more for it, because he will then be their Heavenly Father as well. That's why Paul urges, always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. So you see, we're not trying to make a name for ourselves, but we're rather trying to lift up the name of Jesus. He was willing to serve his Heavenly Father by coming to this earth to serve us through his life and death. And just as Christ was exalted also when after he finished the task, and so also he will, of course, be honored by all, believers and unbelievers alike, when he comes again in glory. So you and I will look forward also to honor, not in this world necessarily, but have a faith that awaits glory forever. Whereas anyone who does not believe in the Lord Jesus will bow their knees on that last day, but they'll be doing so in fear and trembling as to what's going to happen to them. You and I can look forward to that day, knowing that it means for us a glory everlasting along with the Lord Jesus. We'll bow our knees too, as we already do, to glorify our Heavenly Father. So we anxiously await the day when we can personally adore Jesus face to face, because we know that we will be with the Lord forever. Then Jesus will show us off to his Heavenly Father as his trophies. And so at the beginning of this Holy Week, we know what's coming. We know that Jesus suffered and died only a few days later. We know that he also rose again from the dead. We know that 40 days later he ascended into heaven. And we also know that he's coming back again in glory. But because we know all of that, We eagerly await that glory that will be revealed as we who imitate Christ's humility now will live in glory forever with him. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We continue with the next hymn. Son, through whom you have revealed your gracious will. We praise you for the Holy Spirit and his working through the means of grace. Strengthen and defend your church, that by your word and sacraments faith may grow and love toward all may increase. Keep our children in the grace of their baptisms. Enable their parents to train them in lives of faith.
Raise up Christians to serve you in the ministry of your word, in all the happy loss of life.
Preserve our nation in justice and honor. Guide and bless all who make, administer, and judge our laws. Let your blessing rest on planting and harvest, commerce and industry, medicine and science, the arts and culture. Protect all who travel and care for those whose work is difficult or dangerous.
Be with all who devote themselves to any useful task.
Comfort all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. Remember those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those on whom death draws near.
Grant them your love and take them into your tender care.
And dear friends, at this time, I announce to you that Reed and Haley Collins had a baby boy yesterday, and so we pray. Lord of life, We marvel again at the wonderful way in which you bring children into the world. Accept our thanks for holding your protecting hand over this mother in childbirth, and for bringing joy to these parents with the gift of a child. Bless this child. Receive him into your family through the sacrament of baptism, and protect him from every danger of body and soul. Give his parents the love, wisdom, and means to care for this child you have entrusted to them. We ask this in the name of Jesus, the friend of children. Hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Grant these things, Father, for the sake of Jesus, who died and rose again.
Amen.
We pray as Jesus also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O God the Father, source of all goodness, in your loving kindness you sent your Son to share our humanity. We thank you that through him you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. We also pray that you will not forsake us, but will rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, so that we willingly serve you day after day, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We conclude now with the final hymn.
Thank you.
Again, our door offering that we had last Sunday for Christian aid and relief amounted to over $380, but we are going to have it one more time today as well, especially in lieu of some more tornadoes that have taken place. So, in addition to that, on Thursday evening, we will observe Maundy Thursday with a service with Holy Communion and crossword number 7, and then crossword number 8 on Friday. Notice Thursday evening at 6:30, Friday it's at 1:30 in the afternoon. And then I would also call your attention to the schedule for next week, for Sunday, 7 o'clock. I'm planning for a crispy outdoor service. Hope you'll join us for that. And that's crossword number 9. So dress accordingly. And you're welcome to bring a blanket if you wish. In my previous parish, we even supplied blankets for people that came. So then 7:30 breakfast, free breakfast. Come join us for it. And 9 o'clock festival service. And I've never preached on this for Easter. 153 fish. You'll have to join us to see. And there's also going to be Easter baskets this year for kids. So, and one more thing. Congratulations. I knew it was going to draw an awe. Yesterday morning at 10:44, and thank you for our trumpeter, Kim, Grandma Kim. it was wonderful talking to them yesterday. In fact, they're planning right about now to, or very soon, to be going home with the baby. So, anyway. So, and I should tell you, we've already talked about it. They're planning the first Sunday after Easter, just 2 weeks from now, to have baptism of Mom and Kate. So that'll be here in the worship service. God's blessings. There's the food. You make the fellowship. Have a good day.